My name is Wendy Chase, and I am running for state representative from Wallingford in Somersworth, District 18. So I wanted to come tonight to say hello and also just sit in and see what's happening in the school system. And there's, what I'm trying to do is just really, I want to listen to everybody and be able to try to solve some kind of issues or bring things to the state house, which I need to be at. But my husband is Glenn Chase. He's on the planning board. We live right on the corner of Short and Silver Street in the big white house. And I've been a resident of Rollinsford for 7 years, but I'm seven generations here in New Hampshire, so for a long time. I really want to just be able to listen to people and see what little things I can do to try to help anybody have maybe one sleepless night and just know that someone's listening and caring. So thank you. We do have a primary in September, so keep that in mind. Thank you very much.
And this is the district that is shared with Somersworth?
It is. It's Somersworth Ward 1, 3, 4, and 5. 2 is part of Dover.
Yeah,
I know. And I am running as a Democrat as well. I didn't tell you that. But yeah, so we do have a contested.
Oh, we can start.
Right.
I get confused about the representation.
Yes.
Don't look it up.
We can't, we're puddles. We're puddles.
We are waiting for Andy, but we're not going to wait. We're going to call him into order now that the clock has arrived. So if they all rise and advance. Oh, I'm sorry. Roll call. Excuse me. Roll call for a short. So you can all remain standing if you wish.
Judy Nelson.
Here.
Tom Coons. Emily Leach.
She's excused.
Andrea Anderson. Erin Cavanaugh.
Here. Right now, if you will all remain standing, you can pledge allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
see under new business, we have something called residency requirements. We're going to be, the town clerk will be coming over when the office is closed. We're going to have a discussion on what constitutes residency for students at Marshwood or here at RGS. And anyway, when she comes, we're probably going to switch the agenda around so that we don't hold her up too long to meet. She's had a long afternoon serving the public, so that's where we get to do that. But now, back to the actual agenda announcement. So the infrastructure fund update.
Yeah, just a brief update. As you know, there was a project, a entrance, safe and secure entrance, as well as communications. Mm-hmm. And we've got the figure of $63,492, of which we would get 80% back, $50,794. And this has been recommended by the commission. So it's moving forward, and as soon as we hear final approval, we'll let you know.
Excellent.
In process.
This is just a process.
It is.
Thank you. Thank you for the update. Any questions from the board? Okay. Thank you. The next item is the security renovation presentation. And you want to set that up for us, Paul?
Sure. Chris is here. He has a number of drawings, and I can hand those out to the board members. He's got a few different options for consideration. And we can look through these, and then Chris is looking for feedback, and then hopefully a direction on which we can proceed and send it out to get some cost estimates.
Yeah, so thanks for having me, Chris. I'm from St. Louis Architects. Worked with you guys a lot in the past. So when we first came on looking at a secure main entrance, we looked at your existing main entrance. And that presented some problems right off the bat, which we actually looked at, I don't know, 4 years ago now. Such that we can make a secure entrance there, but it's not ADA accessible. So to make it accessible, we know the budget on that, and it would be this fairly large, expensive project. So looked at how else can we make a main entry into this school and do it in a cost-effective way. So we went to kind of your most utilized entrance, which is where we all came in. I don't want to say the back entrance, but the rear entrance of school. What we have here is we've been working with some folks and developed three options for you guys to review and talk about. Each one has some pros and cons, and with some direction, because I want to get the cost in this as well, so then we can discuss that. So I can run through these options. So all three options come in. The main entrance will now be moved to the back of the school. To do that, we need to move the administration over there as well. So admin, as part of the security, that's part of providing the security will be is having admin have direct control and sightings of that entrance. So right now you come in, there's a camera that controls your entrance. You're allowed to come into the building and you can either check in with the principal's office, but people can come and go without that. So we want to have direct visual control of that. So the first option is the most conservative approach. I'd like to run through these, and if we wanted to, we can all go out and actually just look at it in space. We have your existing doors, those stay as is. We do some upgrades to your ramp, just to make it more of a main entry. Bring it up to code. But you come into the building, and we're adding a vestibule. So we'll add a set of doors at that front. Visitors come, they're allowed into the building. So there's then a control point. These doors can then be locked at all times.
So they get into the vestibule?
Yep, get into the vestibule. Yeah, we don't want to keep people outside, yep. Although it's not that bad. Right now you want to be inside too. But most of the year, you need to be able to get inside. You're not out of the cold. And then there'll be a reception window and a door. So you come into the receptions, the admin office. So nobody's coming into the building. And the principal's also up for that. So everybody comes in, meets with the receptionist, and then you're provided access to the building. In terms of beginning of the day, end of the day, these doors will be open, but there's staff there monitoring the door. So you have to come in, circle through, and back out into the space. Some of the concerns we have with this is a main access to the building, and this is getting fairly pinched. It's not a lot of space there. But as you can see, we're adding some doors here, upgrading your existing entrance. We'd like to have a canopy come out and around. One, to act as a visual, this is the main entrance. And also to provide some cover so that you're not tracking everything outside, inside, all around. And then we reworked some walls here. There's two bathrooms here right now off the teacher's room. So those would be removed to provide the principal's office. It's all fairly efficient. The nurse's office also comes over to the entry, having a nurse adjacent to the entrance. So that if there are students here, it's a very easy transition for parents to move up. So and then I'll get into at the end kind of the rework of what we're going to use due to the main front. So that's option one.
I have a question?
Yep.
Yeah. We'll see, as long as it doesn't take too much.
No, I just want to know, because I don't see any custodial closet in there, because you're taking away a custodial closet.
Yeah, well, we'll find out sort of where maybe they're going to move things at the end. So
okay.
So that's, just hold that.
Sorry, this is the beginning.
See where we're going. It's very much.
Well, of course,
we're here for it. You may not have thought that, find out.
Option two is, rather than adding the vestibule on the inside of the building, we've now pushed out. So we'll add a vestibule to the outside. So we're building a new structure off that rear portion of the school. We've moved the ramp over. Part of this is to provide a visibility, but also to, when people are parking here, the natural flow will be up into the school. So you come in, there's now a vestibule. Students exiting and entering would have this clear path to travel. And visitors would come in, check in with the receptionist. There's a small area that you can sit and wait. And if you're invited into the building, you come in to the receptionist, you meet with the principal, and then come out into the space. So it kind of functions the same way, but it just provides a little bit more space for everybody there. So that's option two. Over here, there could be a garden space. We're just bringing out a paved space that people remain as that. But again, not a lot of renovation to the inside. We're trying to keep this as efficient as possible. So we're taking out those two bathrooms, receptionist, and the nurse over here. That make sense? Three. Goes a bit further. So the problem with those first two options is the entrance, although we have a canopy coming around to attract people's eye and give them some wayfinding so they know where the main entry is, the entry is still around the side. So how do we solve it? We pull the entry out to right off the main parking lot. So you come to a new ramp into the side of the building, and then put in two new doors, new double door. You come into the building with the vestibule. So this is within that existing, kind of where the two bathrooms are, through the storage room. Come in through there, come in, security acts the same way, this door will be locked. Come in to the reception, meet with the receptionist, and you're allowed access to the building. Or, the benefit of this is, if there's parents coming in that need to meet with somebody, they don't need to have access to any other parts of the building. So staff, administration, they would come over and meet with them in the conference room, and then which is taking it that much further in terms of security, not allowing anybody into the building. You really don't need to be there unless you're meeting somebody. You will meet here. It also provides an extra office space, so if you have a counselor or a future vice principal, somebody, you have that extra flexible office space. And then off of that, you've got a kind of a print copy area. And then the nurse again is moved over. So, rework to the main portion of the building is the existing main entry. Come in, come up some steps, which provides that, well, it's a hindrance of the ADA. The existing nurse's suite over here will be turned into two new ADA accessible unisex bathrooms for either students or faculty, rather than just straight unisex and gaming bathrooms. Two new unisex bathrooms. There's space here for custodial, so you have closets, even though I know you have this space over here for storage. And then your existing admin space would be the teacher's room, which can also double as a small group learning space, and then the print room and kitchen. So like that. Kind of the three options, if we wanted to look at it, or if it kind of makes sense here, that's fine.
It does make sense, but do people want to go see it within the space? Or is it up to you guys? We've all been here and out there.
I've
been going back though to Dick's concern. Because basically this building is broken up into two big pieces. So what is being done, or what is proposed for sort of utility closet work area? And maybe there's even the thought of having two of them.
Right now we have three. We've got one upstairs, one downstairs, and one right here on this.
It would make sense just to have one on this side of the building, between to those of us who, just because there's so much distance between them and equipment.
It's quite efficient to have something, not have something.
So that's something to think about.
Is that the plan though, or any of those plans? Like, is there room for that, or is there consideration?
We have not had that in, but that's exactly why we're here, is to get that.
And then will there be no bathrooms on the side?
Oh, bathrooms right here. So I did just tell two existing
bathrooms. Oh, okay. So what was removed were the bathrooms for, there's
a bathroom and a utility closet.
Oh, that's it. Oh, yeah, it's just a bathroom there and a utility closet.
There's a bathroom and a utility closet.
So the nurse would have they have their own single-use bathroom, the nurse's suite, and then these two game bathrooms.
And there's a bathroom that right there for the nurses. There's a bathroom there at the moment, right? I see.
In this room?
No, this room. That room right now is more of a printing office.
Okay.
And there's a bathroom over here, but the existing nurses has that.
Yeah, no, I know that. Other questions, observations from the board? Or from Dick?
Is there a shower facility in the nurses'
area?
We
talked about it, and the discussion was it wasn't needed, but we also talked about having just in case you have faculty or staff, or in case a student needs to take a shower. I know a lot of times in the mornings the kids filter in and take a shower. Is there enough space here that we could have a single shower stall there? We actually had that in options.
Is it code to have two ADA accessible bathrooms, or could we get rid of one?
Well, essentially, overall, the schools are a neat code to run the building fixtures, so we're improving the situation. So, it would be nice to have two, but it's not.
But one is also a step up.
Yeah.
And it also then we can use a little more room for perhaps other things. But, I don't know what it is.
This won't bring it up to meet code anyways, so.
Right. I guess that's.
Nor do we have to, because it's an existing building. So, yes, one would be great, two would be.
And it doesn't affect our standing if we are changing things.
No, there's a 40% of the school threshold, so we're not close to that.
So one of the first things that jumps out at me is that other than the first plan, we are losing parking spaces, and our parking spaces here are at a real premium. We can't fit all of our staff as it is. So that's the first thing that jumps out at me, and I don't know if there's any other things.
Yeah, that's a good point.
There might be.
There might be. Right. This area, and I think it might just be two organizations on that side of the building. I'm not sure. Because there's part of it that's being used for parking, and of course it's shops. I don't know if there are trees out there. side of the back, on the other side of that, the storage.
Out on the back or on the side where we added parking last year?
No, yeah, more on the back.
Where we added parking or?
On the side.
No, can we add more parking?
So we could have went down, we just didn't.
We could have.
Get into.
That might.
Okay, well, that's good to know.
Yeah, we could probably put another 5 or 6 spots there. Without.
I think if you first commit to, can't you do some, you could do some angled nosing parking?
Yeah, we could dig in, it would have to be, we didn't, at that time, we didn't take the money to dig into the side of that upgrade, because we would have had to put a little retaining. We went as far as we could without having to put any retaining on.
And in general, Chris, it looks like 1, 2, 3 is sort of, you know, least expensive, next expensive, next most expensive. Is that sort of how they run?
Yeah, it's the most expensive on cost.
That's the next step, is figuring out the cost. Wanted to get, you know, if you have a preferred option, develop that a little more, and also the pricing.
And that the pricing is still part of the study that we.
Yep.
Other things to share? I have to say that for me, and I can't speak for anyone who's in the job, but I don't like the principal being totally out of sight on option 3. The principal's off in the corner, and students walking by, if you wanted to wave at them or do something, I mean, that's just me. Maybe it's fine, I don't know.
I actually like it.
Do you like it?
I do. I think that it's having the reception area there. I think it's given kind of taking the principal out of the main drag, so to speak. They're right, you know, they're in the corner, they've got, you know, they can see through there because the reception area is there. I'm assuming all windows in front of that. Less disturbance. If the principal's right there, you don't want necessarily kids knocking on the window the minute they walk in.
After, I mean, it is true that the principal, certainly at this school, it's common for the principal to be out and about a lot, and
right.
Then maybe when the principal's in the office, they want to be able to concentrate on what they're
exactly.
Doing in the office. So, I mean, so maybe it's not a big deal. Do you want to weigh in on that, Rich?
Well, one of my initial concerns with the setup is not very challenging.
Yep.
Walls are paper thin. And I don't have a lot of trust in personnel in the office because depending on how loud the people talking in my office are, everything can hurt. And the other piece is that there's the bathroom between my office and classroom, even though there's some soundproof material on the door, you can still hear it. Have something that's newer and out of the line of sight is more confidential.
Yeah, so it's not a bad, necessarily a bad thing.
Yeah, I mean, I'm out of sight where I am now.
That's true, you are.
Yeah.
That's true.
It would just be a different location.
We could switch you. If you move you over here, you'd have better sight lines. You have a window here.
My guess is that the principal would probably be out when the kids are coming in anyway. You'd be out and about. Probably, unlikely you'll just be sitting in the office, you know, at the beginning of the day, probably seeing what's going on. So your point about confidentiality and, you know, other discussions in there, and obviously if you all knew instructions, so that can be taken. I think it's a good idea to have that for the area that you're not being used to. That's just another office nearby. Is that for other?
That would be either for a counselor or another admin, or we can expand the principal's office so you can have a small conference table yourself. You know, 2-3 people.
So that option, the principal's office, would be the current.
No,
nope. This is all new. This is
new.
Bumped out.
So that's new. Book.
Yes, and the existing is the black here.
Okay.
This wall right there is the existing want to squeeze this, actually.
So, yeah, the dollars are bad.
Yeah, I mean, in option three that we're looking at here right now, with the principal office in the corner, there is a lot of extra space, which doesn't have to be conference room and extra office. It could be a custodial closet. It could be other things. That gives us a little extra space, admin space or custodial space or counselor space or whatever.
Yeah, I can see this easily becoming with extra space.
Other questions and thoughts?
It's about 12 feet, I'm guessing.
But in that option there, I wonder if you just...
Tom, the difference in the middle question.
I just wanted to know how much space, you're pumping it out, how far?
That was...
It's sort of things here, build it, bring it out 12 feet.
It's going to match. It's going to match the other wall. It's what it looks like, yeah.
So the principal office will be 12 by 12?
Roughly, yeah. And again, this wall, maybe this wants to be more print work area or storage. So this wall can just slide over. If you will, think you need a small table, which could be nice if you have small meetings, if this one's being used, you can just bring people right into your office maybe.
And what's above the current extra office?
Print copy room.
So this is just a workspace.
Yeah, the print copy room is really on the other side, isn't it? The teachers, there's a print space there.
It is thinking, small print copy room up here for teachers and small print copy room back here rather than the herd all showing up at the same time. There's a bit of a rush for that.
Another piece, a nice piece of thought three is that it allows you not only a conference space, but a small place to meet with kids or a small place to meet with the parents one on one, so that's nice to you.
Yeah, it is nice. Now, Tom, I know that I cut you off.
I think that there's a, you mentioned that one sliver there that you wrote right there. What would that be?
You could have storage back here.
It's
or you could have janitor
access.
Or you could have janitor access through the bathroom.
That's why I saw that as the bathroom, and then you have storage in back. And I think almost as a standalone, more convenient. You don't know what is going to be brought in and out of there at any given time. So that I agree with. I think the storage, that area really needs to be easily accessible. Mm-hmm. It should be, excuse me, kids, coming in, the more just we're able to get to this stuff, whatever it is.
If I can interject, we have that current bathroom that we just need for this staff, that would be another option for it.
Yes, and I was thinking that too, because there will now be more nurses' office, there will be other bathrooms available, and I was thinking that too, that that's a spot too. So there are options.
Well, another option with this one is you could keep this as your janitorial space, and if you didn't think you needed as such a big conference room, you could put the nurse over here.
Well, the other thing too is your plumbing is on that same side, so that might be more beneficial. Or is there plumbing already in that?
Yes. Yes, there's plumbing. There's the teacher's bathroom that was added to the opposite side of the boys and girls' rooms, right?
Yeah. The way I see this right now, this here is.
This is the present copy.
Yep.
This is the bathroom. That's often that we made for the teachers to get the parking lot. There is plumbing in here.
The access is a hatch.
There's a door here that goes into this room. So that's under the reading expressions. Right here is where we have. You're going to get rid of the two of the bathroom and the custodial closet. This is too small. Right now, where this room here is, there's a wall going right here that could. That would become where that storage space is now going to become a custodial. It's about 3 feet. There is a wall on
the street. All right, so let's try not to get too far in the weeds. Let's think about sort of the
Yeah, we want to get, we'll get into all these little improvement details, door hardware and all that. But it's really, this was a bigger kind of renovation, a different approach than how do we make this the simplest entry and most cost effective approach? But if this seems like a viable option, you're getting a lot for the space. You've got a property in the office, you have a conference room, you have another small group learning teacher's room, then we can accommodate all those other things in there.
The other thing that it does is it almost allows this building to be part of these two buildings as we try to look way into the future and try to think of what's going to happen here. You know, we're going to stay at K-6 school for the next 20 years. Who knows?
This is not really, this, none of the stuff that we're talking about, though, has anything to do with instructional orders.
That is correct.
These are all safety,
yes.
Vestibule, you know, we've been talking about this for forever. All of these rooms are for different purposes than the instructional. So
yes.
I think we really can't even bring that into the picture. This, the way that is right now, it's not terribly useful. You're saying that the walls are extremely paper thin, you can put your hands in the hand for them.
It's just too much drywall. It's drywall and some metal stuff.
Right. So this kind of presents, first of all, it presents a whole new main entrance, very close to where kids are getting dropped off now anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Out front, it's a little more harrowing. The road's not that wide. People pulling over, parking in front of a tree, letting kids out. I don't know if it alleviates any of the parking woes, but if we're able to use some of the area over there, that's, that, like you said, we didn't go that far. We could present six more spaces.
Yeah, we could probably go all the way down. We go as far as we want.
That might be helpful. But this is all really just administrative.
Well, safety,
office,
yeah.
You know, storage,
it's
having a nurse's area.
Children. I mean, to me, it's safety and security.
Yeah.
We're not for the secure building.
I also like the fact that we have the nurse's office over there, right at that main entrance. So parents come in, pull up, they can get their kids easily rather than, you know, it might become a little more of a problem. I also think there's not for anything, but that front entrance right now, remember the time I walked out of that building and I slipped down that, remember we were leaving the meeting? That's gets kind of wild out there, especially at nighttime. If there isn't, you know, people are leaving out of that way. That's more of a cleared out area. You have a canopied area, which I think is very helpful. And if I'm not mistaken, there would be any steps up.
There might not be an entrance at the very front of the building. There would no longer be an entrance. There might be a So I mean, at the front of the building now would be, it could just be a facade. It wouldn't be a real entry.
We'd need the steps, and we would need that for egress purposes. It's certainly required.
Yeah.
And I don't know if historically we could get rid of the steps, but
right, historically shouldn't.
But essentially, those would not be used unless it was required.
And what is that little up? You know, so outside the principal's office, to the right there, there's this little up. Is that a ramp?
So a ramp coming in. Because grades do, they rise as you come around the building. It comes, so that right now you don't have any ramp coming in.
Right, so, okay, so if it's up here on the side, you can
right. Because this slopes down, so we have to be more
grades. Yeah, it's coming right over here. Other thoughts and questions as we think about where to go next? And see, it sounds like we're zeroing in on this one that gives
us. I'm sort of not zeroing in on that one. As we mentioned, security is the first concern. Also, some confidentiality for the nurse's office. And really, all three of these plans do those things. So, to my mind, I think ensure the secure entrance, check those boxes, and then go for a cost solution option. Granted, you haven't seen the differences between these three approaches, but I don't know that we need all this. This is great on option three, but it seems like pumping out the building, it's going to be really expensive. That's sort of my first thought.
And I would also parking. I would make sure that what we're losing, we can sort of pick up, because we're hurting if it is assembly.
But how many parks in that area?
Well, let's just leave it to the school day, where we have staff and
right, folks here. I'm saying in the area where
right.
This is, there is no park. There's no parking now.
They can come right to the edge of the building, so yes, yes indeed, there is parking.
This one is
on
that side.
How much are we losing the parking space?
Yeah, that's
on option three.
Right, 5 spot.
So, I mean, I guess.
But is it, you're only losing from here to here.
We may gain 8 spots over there.
It's only about
2. But I absolutely agree. I mean, it's like, that needs to be the primary. It needs to be the safety. Absolutely. That if there's a way to do this, that having a lot more done at once. I mean, that's all going to be my ask, not the cost. But the cost is ridiculous.
Yeah, we'll just have to see what it is.
Yeah, and I think we have to get an idea of cost, and it sounds like we're going to have to get an idea of cost for the what is considered the least expensive, and at least the range. And we're going to get it. We need to get an idea of the range, because we don't know if there's going to be money available from the state, and we don't know if there's going to be money available from nationally.
Yeah.
Or we just don't know, and until we get an idea of what's going to cost, any thoughts on that one?
Well, I would hope that we would know the infrastructure fund within the next couple months. And, but yeah, I agree with you, but it comes down to cost. From what I'm hearing, it'd be nice to get at least the cost on two of these, so we can get a better idea of what you're talking about. So I think that's my problem.
Sound like a good approach to support yes. Next? And how long do you think that might take, Chris? Not that you want to rush it, because it's not like
well, then, are there any deadlines you guys need to hit going forward?
Not at this point, because we don't know that we can't say yes because we know we have to apply for this grant or we have to apply for this money. We don't know. Unless the problem is paid for something new.
No, I would say, I mean, what's realistic, Chris? In a couple of months?
Oh, less than that. I think 4 or 6 weeks tops.
Okay.
This last section is tough with bids. Everybody rushing to finish their projects for school to start. So to get an accurate estimate is difficult. We don't want to rush them too much because then you get these numbers that really don't mean much. So if we can get it to an estimator and say give them 3-4 weeks to do the estimate, then we can go back and prepare a kind of a full project budget and come back with you guys. So.
That's fine. That hits us at a good point in our budget process.
I think it's wise to get a couple of costs. Is there a plan here that the board doesn't want cost at?
I think if we did 1 and 3, the other one would falls in the middle.
It's really
yeah. I mean, that's or it falls between them. Yeah. You know, it won't be more than that or less than that.
Yeah, we'll send this out to a cost estimator and then also be with some construction managers to see their take and file all that and go back and talk about this.
All right.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll see what the next step takes us. Thank you very much.
Is there being any of these larger reports?
Thanks, sir.
I think we get this model.
Not until we get a little further.
All right.
Appreciate it. Yeah, stay cool. I hope your air conditioner works.
Maybe it still works.
As I mentioned to folks earlier, I said There have always been questions every school year, pretty much. What, school kind of figures out their own residency requirements. Marshwood has obviously figured out, apparently, their own residency requirements. To be an official resident of Rollinsford is all that matters to the board. If the child is an official resident of Rollinsford, then they are entitled to attend the schools that we support. So that's what we're concerned about.
Right. My concern is people are coming in with different requests from Marshwood. They want a voter registration card, which you can come in and vote, register to vote, and you're welcome instead. It doesn't really make you a resident. Or they'll bring in a lease, which, you know, I can print the lease off so that if I'm over the street, I can't give anybody. I mean, these are things that, when I worked for the city of Portsmouth, we didn't take any of those because there was so much fault. So, as a town clerk, it's our job to make sure that these people are legitimately living in town. So we take a utility bill or a pay stub. We do something a little more, you know, secure. But we've had requests in this week of a woman who wanted a letter, wanted us to write a letter that she was a resident. Because she's going to take custody of her niece or somebody who's coming in. So we need to have some kind of a, I would almost think that you guys would require like an affidavit or something that they sign stating that they...
So school aside, how do you determine who's a resident of Rollinsford?
We use a utility bill or a pay stub.
So there's that. And that now there's another layer to it, you said, where they say, well, my niece is coming, or my grandchild is coming to live with me, and I'm the official guardian.
And obviously they don't pay stuff or anything, you know.
So they are official residents of Rollinsford, these folks.
The person, yes.
And so what? How then do we, so how do we determine, for instance, you know, with the Bob and Rich also on this, how do we determine in custody, for instance, if how do we determine that if a child is 100% a resident of Rollinsford, custody in Rollinsford,
how do we determine that? And how does it follow on my supposed to, or is the school? I mean, these students are, you know, expensive for the family. We want to be sure that, you know, they're just not disliking the school system they're in, and I'm just saying, she's living over here, and she's really not. It's expensive.
It is. This is not an exact science. Because there are so many different variables that enter into it. Technically, as far as, I mean, we get everything from guardianship to custody to divorce papers to, you know, the whole nine yards. So basically what we do to try to determine residency, we'll look for things like a mortgage payment. We'll look for car registrations. We'll look for pay stubs. We'll look for electric bills.
So the one thing that isn't sure about that is like a mortgage payment, because we have people who own here and don't live here.
Yep.
So mortgage payment really is going to have your name and address. But
that's why we try to couple that with an electric bill or something like that.
Electric bills is also good because they show the physical address.
Yep.
You know, people can get a PO box and come in with a PO box.
And as far as education goes, the residency requirements legally have changed over the last decade and gotten much more lenient. As far as custody, if a parent lives in Rollinsford and a parent lives in Dover, the child can live either. And then on top of that, the homeless laws have money for residency for sale. Like I said, it's not an exact science. We try to do the best we can. We had those phone calls this week.
Right, and we just
and we try
keep
to
getting a different request.
Yep.
And we just need to have one like mainstream.
Hopefully, you're never been in this situation. Dog.
writing somewhere. So why wouldn't we just as a request, and this is a suggestion, even if it does, if you say there's a 50-50, I mean, if the 50-50, we have to honor. If the person, one of the parents lives here and they have 50% custody, we have no choice. They can make the decision where they want to go. But if it's in writing, why wouldn't we request as proof that, you know, that document or something in that document that says, you know, as part of whatever divorce agreement or custody agreement, this child, you know, identified child is living with this adult. You know, even I get it, you know, Aunt Sally wants to take in, you know, her daughter, but that doesn't really apply to us. We're not obligated.
It's a temporary custody.
But there should still be something in writing which, you know, makes it easier for you. I mean, you're gonna look at it.
We get this every year right before the school year.
If there is something in writing, we always follow that. So anytime there's something like that. I can't even explain the number of different scenarios that we get. We get people that are, a mother and child might be moving from another town and living with a relative in town, rent-free, just living there.
Right.
They've got basically nothing to demonstrate that they're permanent residents of your town. But if they're living there, and sometimes we ask them to do a signed affidavit that they're living there, and we have the homeowner sign a affidavit. But
if somebody moves here to this town and is living here, even if it's temporary, you see, because then you have to say, well, what is it temporary? What does that mean? 6 months, 2 years, 5 weeks? Is there a requirement by the state, especially if they're a car registered or a license? Do they have to change their address on that as well?
10 days, April.
Okay, so we're going by that. But
right.
We assume that that person, if they're going to say, I'm living here.
Right, go through those responsible acts and get it changed.
Get it changed.
But that's where we...
I don't think the problem is with adults. Who have cars and electric cars.
Yeah,
that doesn't seem to be the problem. But with children, some children are in circumstances where they are indeed not in a stable home environment, and sometimes they have to leave that or wherever they were for 3 months or 6 months or a year or whatever it is. And as people who care about education, we want that child to be educated. And if they're living in our town, we need to be responsible.
But none of these 6-year-olds, 7-year-olds are living in our own home.
Or they're going to a custody of.
Right, but again, it goes back to. I'm assuming, hopefully I'm correct, that there are no homeless 8-year-olds in this town.
That is a big assumption to make.
Okay,
but
is it safe to also assume that there is an adult? And if there isn't, they have a parent with them, or a legal guardian, or somebody who's acting as a guardian with them. If they're living in this town, that guardian is living in this town, then, okay, it does go back to the adult. It does go back to that person. So, again, and
that's what we're trying to accomplish, is that we accept the same paperwork.
Yes.
When they come in one day, they want to register to vote so that they can put their kid in high school on the same day, but that's not how it works. And then we got a call, this girl's moving in with her boyfriend, and she won't get active and she doesn't work. And I mean, we try to make it, you know, change it with the post office, with the federal government, but they have nothing.
The other piece of this is that the state is very aggressive at saying, you figure the stuff out with the adults, you need to register the child today.
Right.
And that to
and
me
if it takes you a day, if it takes you a week, if it takes you a month to track down a driver's license or something like that, they're very aggressive at saying, register the child today.
But that state, no state, there is no state that would require you as a school district to register a child in this school district, or any school district, if you don't know they live here. There has to be some attachment. There has to be...
Well, that's what Bob's saying, there is.
Right, but no, just stepping into the town, you know, into the town boundaries doesn't make you a resident.
No, and that's, I think we're all saying the same thing here, Katie, if you want to...
I just want to say that the calls that we had this week are basically because Marshwood was told a few years ago that they cannot accept utility bills as a requirement from the Burlington School Board. So when people were coming, they had to provide, I found emails back, so...
By the Burlington...
By the superintendent stating that that's not...
Okay, because they didn't hear from the school board, because I know Kate has always been very clear that it's a utility bill.
This is Marshwood.
Yeah, no, I know, but I mean...
So they won't accept the utility, is that the problem that you're having? That's why they're coming to the town, because if they don't, they were told they could only have a mortgage or a lease, or a letter from the town, or their resident tax from the town. So it'd be two circumstances that were this week. It was people who had paid off their mortgage, but they did not have a mortgage statement. They're over 65, so they don't pay a resident's tax. So there was no other option for them to bring to the Marshwood Trail.
So we approved it off the electric bill.
Electric bill and the guardianship. And so that, I think that's why you're running into so many issues right now, is because Marshwood was told they could not accept the utility.
So does it come down to, I mean, it seems to me that yes, it was doing a great job of this, and we're trying to do a great job of this. And the problem is that people are coming, that Marshwood is saying to residents when they go into residence, oh, go talk to your town clerk.
They
really need to go talk to.
Yeah, but the good thing about that is that we know Marshwood's keeping track of it.
We just have to have
an even flow, because when somebody walks in and demands a letter, first of all, we're responsible for the wording of that letter.
Right.
And people don't realize when they move into town, when we register their vehicle, they say to me, well, what's the deal? You only want my $200-$300? As soon as we register that vehicle, you're entitled to our transfer station, our schools, voting, you become a resident. And born or name, people want to register in here because it's less to register and less to insure. So we've always had this battle, you know, but we can't have people coming in and demand that we grade this letter.
If you have any of those calls and they're putting you in a tough, just call us. And we'll, like, we talked it over, and I think we had three of them this week.
Yeah, three. Always this time of year from now.
We just talked it over and said, this is what we need, and signed up on it.
Yeah, as long as we've got to be on the same page.
Right.
That, you know, you can't take a lease, and mortgage statement really doesn't.
Just understand that there are times that we're going to have to register the child and then go after the paperwork.
Okay. I'm happy to hear this conversation. Go ahead, Andrew.
Well, I was just going to say, you know, each year here at Rollinsford, every beginning of the school year, I've always filled out paperwork, and I've had to have two proofs of residency, a utility bill, and I forget what the other, a mortgage statement.
I don't know that.
But,
oh, I never said.
Well, after
I did this once, I lived here, that's it.
But I've been doing it every year.
Well, thank you, Mayor. You're rules follower.
I was late tonight, but I get a
question.
But this isn't a unique situation. In my last districts, all three of them tuitioned their children to different high schools, and we had this same discussion every year, all year. You know, you get a lot of different situations. We just do the best we can at going out and trying to get the paperwork, and if we need to do a visit to the house or resource officer or whatever we need to do.
Well, we never have this problem as much as Summersworth, but Marshall is December. Yeah. It's what they really want.
Yes, and with Summersworth, we were in the same school district, so we're in the same SMU, sorry, not the same school district.
But it's not that Marshall is requesting things that are requesting different information.
Right.
They don't know that they're saying that we're...
They were told that they were not allowed to accept the utility bill. So that's where the disconnect is coming from.
So, because the utility bill not only gives you the address, if you flip it over, it doesn't belong again there. So, you know, it gives you a
information that maybe we can move into town and work out the next.
Well, I think, go ahead.
Do we want to, maybe we can check again, like what we do for paperwork here again? I mean, off the top of my head, I recall filling this out. I had to do my utility bill and one other.
It's not a bad idea because, you know, once you pass muster,
sure, I'd be in the hospital for.
Although the person isn't, just the scenario, the person isn't the one with the utility bills. Their name is on.
You can get added to the utility bill. That's what we recommend because we get couples that come in that are not married and I mean, the utility bill, the company will do that. You just have to show a responsible act. And when people come in and they're angry and they refuse to do anything, they won't change their license, they won't go to the post office, they've got all these reasons. My mother gets my mail, well, you're 34, so why are we mailing your mail to Durham?
No problem with my mom getting it.
They've heard it all. But, you know, they don't work, they don't get mail, they can't change their license. It just goes on and it becomes a.
There's a lot of evidence. Yeah, a lot of evidence situations that you've checked into. So if you get a call, just let us know.
Okay. But in the meantime, let's go back to, you know, we don't want anyone coming in demanding things on the spot, letters. Well, there isn't even a board registration card that I can, I mean, we maintain one at the office, but I can't.
I would not have us, have you expand what it is that you accept for residency. Now, in terms of school, I would say refer any of them to the SAU office. If they come in and say, well, I'm trying to register my child at Murphy, please talk with the superintendent Budowski. He'll talk with the superintendent there. I think that's the best thing to do.
I have a list of things now that are we consider as, you know, out on the website. It says we can accept the following things will be accepted.
Right.
Towards proof of residency.
And on this form that we fill out every year that you haven't been doing.
We can touch base with Marshwood and ask what they're using for a criteria now and just make sure that that's where.
Yeah, just have a send me an email. We just, so we're on the same page. Day to day, we get different requests.
And I would strongly recommend that you do not go into the business of writing a letter for someone.
Yes.
I mean, you don't have the administrative support yet.
Somebody's coming in there to register their vehicle. You request certain things.
Absolutely.
So
it's that kind of thing, right?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. That's part of our job. The town clerk is our job to make sure that you are resident before we because it opens a lot of doors. It's not just here's my $400 in my car, why don't you just take it and shut up? That's not okay.
It's not your job to assure that a child who's living in their home at this time is legal to be registered for school.
I just needed to express that we can't have these different demands coming in. And it always happens. We'll get them 2 days before school starts.
Oh, yeah.
We can't force responsibility, but we certainly can call Marshwood and make sure we're on the same page.
This next generation is online.
They bring their mother in with them.
All right, so thank you for coming in.
You're welcome.
I hope that this is a little bit cleared up. And the other thing, of course, for the school here, you need to know is utility bill, it's going to go to the utility bill. All right, thank you.
Thank you
for that discussion. All right, going back to our regular agenda, we are up to the voluntary appropriation payment schedule. It was simply part of, it was in our communications, it was mailed out to the budget committee earlier and the select board and everything, so it's it basically reflects what the budget and the warrant articles that were passed in March, it reflects what the payments are to cover.
And it'll be revised once the tax rate.
Once the tax rate is set again in November, it'll be revised. Any comments or questions on that? discussion items, the principal's report. We've had our first report from Rich. Nicely done.
Feedback on the format? I just.
That was great. I thought it was great too.
And the sections will change as the year goes on. I have the headings may change.
The new K-1 teacher, Caitlin, can you pronounce her last name?
Riendo.
Riendo, thank you.
The teaching staff down in the side of the building, not just the side themselves. They're so thrilled.
Good. And then you probably had a number of staff members on the committee that's the hiring committee.
Yeah, I had Cheryl Horton, Lindsay Kitchen, and Noah Conley.
That's a nice cross section. Excellent. I'd like to. I know that we were not at the forefront of hiring. We were so late in the game, but.
We're not. I know it was. I'm not sure if you folks know, but my secretary is in there.
Bob just informed me, and I guess so.
Thank you. Before she's gone, that my job becomes a thousand times harder.
Yes, I mean, she'd be nervous. And but do you have to teach her too? She's good at this. Yes.
She's for a good reason. I mean, she travels 2 hours for a trip every day. She can handle it.
Oh. For her, I know she's been, but I do know that she will be quite lost. Yeah.
And she's very dysfunctional. She's very upset because she loves her job. So, which is a good feeling for her.
Yeah.
She's not leaving.
Any questions on the questions?
So we're going to get right on posting for that.
As soon as we get posted already.
I have interviews tomorrow.
Yeah. Oh, good.
Yeah. Oh, excellent.
I'm starting interviews tomorrow. It'll go into next week. But I grabbed a couple and I've got phone calls to make.
Good luck. Good luck. Because that is. That's a key position for them, especially for, well, even if you're all new, it's still good to have someone in that position.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we'll all have to take shifts in between the phones here.
I was thinking that, you know. Tom's good on the phone.
Tom's great on the phone. Oh, Tom would be wonderful.
He would be.
Oh, okay, good. We got that, we got that in here. I'll make sure you're done.
My jeans are all Tom's.
And certainly, thank you for your update on the buildings and grounds too. I mean, that things are really moving along. It looks like the tug work has started on the roof.
Yes.
And who has pool work started yet?
Well.
A little bit soon.
Yes. No. To your first question, yes. To your second.
Okay. Excellent.
I think the weather has held back a lot of things. Slowed up down on waxing and things drying the pink coats.
Yeah.
And then with the last couple of weeks with a lot of rain, or anything companies can set that on bright jobs. But we're hopeful that both projects will be done. So just starting to really push and both of them. But that is the
thing. Thank you. Good report. So as we all know, our Marshwood student rep, Noah Nijakowski, graduated and will be attending the college soon. I ran into him at the library the other day. He was doing independent study on something that's just interesting. And anyway, he'll be off to UNH in a couple of weeks. And you did speak with Dr. Nash.
Yeah, along those lines, I met with Dr. Nash last week. Late last week, and that was one of the things that we talked about for finding a student rep.
Excellent. Sure. That's good.
So we do have at least one action item today, and that is the annual renewal of our heating fuel contract.
The contracts in the packet, that's the same price we received for last year, so it's 18 cents over the cost per gallon on the way of delivery. I did contact the town, and they're receiving the same price as my bill, so once you approve it, it'll be theirs.
So any questions on that or comments we want to make? And we'll take a motion to accept the contract.
Motion to accept the contract.
Second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Who signs?
I have it with me. I wasn't sure either who signed, but I brought it with me.
Okay, yep. After the signs, it's going to pass it. All of you didn't see my email when I emailed Katie and said, wait, there's no budget information. But she said, well, I was going to talk about it.
Yeah, we're still trying to close out for last year. I still received bills this week for last year, so we're closing that out. So probably in the September packet, you'll have ending year last year and so far where we're at this year.
Okay, but that's good. And obviously, you're going to get bills continually because the money for the capital was encumbered last year, so they have the purchase order.
Yes. Yes.
That's going to continue.
Mm-hmm. Those will be put on as payables.
Okay. All right. Any questions? I will just give a quick update on the budget committee August meeting that was held, I believe, August 1st. Emily was very good. She really found her voice. She attended the first meeting. She's been very well. I'll get her to get her report, and she was very good. She had her answers there. Move right along. So they'll start getting more interested as we get into as budget season goes on. So that. All right. So new business. We've already did the residency requirements, and we're going to quickly sort of do a quick review of our goals for last year, and then finalize our goals for this year. So last year, it might be a little too hot to do some of these things. I'll leave it till next day. Until next year. Our goals persist. Our goals persist, which is true. I think the important thing to say right now is that we're trying to carry on with some. Maybe we'll get them both on the agenda the next time so everyone can sit along and we'll put them down. All right, so by consensus, we are moving away. We're done with that one. And I apologize for this, but I've added another new business item which had to do with, I should have done it right away, actually. Right now, there are two dates in February for the deliberative sessions because we have the town that will now be holding a deliberative session and the school will be holding a deliberative session. The town has asked that they go first, that they have a first date. And that's because they've never been SB2 before. They don't have the same administrative support that we have. And they're going to need that extra week to get everything ready for the ballot and do all that work. So, right now, the school is scheduled for February 2nd, which is the deliberative session, and the town for February 9th. They would like to flip those. Have the school go February 9th, and have the town go February 2nd. So, Katie, if you could just double check if that works okay for us, or if you bought what the year works. And I think I checked, it is not the Saturday before vacation week. That's the other thing I want to make sure of. It's not. So, because that would have been very difficult to do with that. So that's the expectation. If you could just let Emily know that she would like the budget. All right. I believe that actually brings us, and if it doesn't, I've dripped all over the agenda. I have no idea. Facilities Board for now. Our next meeting is September 13th, our next school board meeting. When is the SAU meeting?
17th.
And that will be our first SAU meeting. And Tom will be setting the agenda as well for that one. So. All right. School events are already laid out in the principal update. So that's very nice. All of you do take note of the school open house, which I believe is the 11th. Some of you are still students here will wonder about, and I wonder about, and I come wonder about, so it's always a good time. Always a good time. Closing comments by visitors. Yes?
I have a question.
Yes, could you just identify yourself?
Sharon Summer. I read the sandwich on the corner.
She's a bigger
one. Sharon Pinnard.
Pinnard?
Yeah.
Thank you.
It says on here, the law disallows K-2 students in classrooms in the original building due to the stairs. Last year, there was a second grade class in there, and so is there this year. How is that working?
A second grade class in where?
The main building. Where it states right there, it's disallowed by the law.
Was it a 2-3 class?
It is a 2-3.
That's probably why that's probably, it's probably classified.
There's still second graders. Right. How is one second grader safe and the other one not? How do you make that determination?
That's a really good question.
I'm not aware of what you were reading, so.
It's just a quarterly that they put out. It's written by the school board, I'm assuming. That's what it sounded like. They're not part of the 1-2, but they're not part of the 3-4. talking about team building, get you to know each other. There's a tiny handful of third graders in there that are constantly left out of everything. They don't go on these field trips. They don't do these events. They don't do these events. They don't do these events. And yeah, a lot of people love the school, love the multi-age. I get it, I've done multi-age. But we're leaving this little group out every time. It's frustrating. And a lot of parents are like, well, it's the 3-4 going. You wouldn't say that if your child was left out again. So yeah, the majority of parents are happy about the 3-4 and the 2-3, but not really the people in the 2-3. So that's something to consider about this Promise Center. It is great. And the third graders and the fourth graders, we've talked about forever, except for that little group of third graders that is left out once again. So it's just something to think about. You know, when things come around and it's like, well, there's outliers that are unhappy, that's the 2-3. We even asked the dad of the 2-3. Nope, we're in the 2-3 again. So, it's hard. So we can look at that, not just for one student, but for all of them. They are getting left out.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments. We appreciate it. Any other comments?
Can I write down your phone number so I can get active?
Thank you all very much for coming out on this hot evening. We do have non-public, so unfortunately we have to stay a little bit longer.